Hello, Nath.
Hello, Trev. How you doing, mate?
Yeah, I'm all right. You?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'm good, mate. I'm good, thanks, yeah.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to We Need to Talk About Movies podcast this week. Nath, I'll let you tell people what we need to talk about, even though they've seen the title of the podcast and they probably already know. Nathan?
Well, this week, I decided to choose the film. Well, no, we spoke about it and you were like, do you have a film you'd like to suggest? And I racked my brains about it for a while. And there was one film that stood out in my mind purely because of its title. And it was a film that I watched a few years ago on Netflix, I think it was. And it's called The Man Who Killed Hitler and Then Bigfoot.
The Man Who Killed Hitler and the Bigfoot. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd never even heard of this film. I'd never even heard of it. But I don't know how this passed me by. It looks like it's right up my street. Yeah, so Nathan says, it left it to the sort of last minute. Saturday night, I was like, I still don't know if Nathan's choosing a film or not. I said to my wife, and then I messaged, and he says, he's come back with a film. And she says, what is it? And I said, it's The Man Who Killed Hitler and Then the Bigfoot. And she went, what the hell's that? And then Elise, my daughter, who's six, said, see, Dad, this is why you shouldn't let Nath choose films. And but no, you know, it's a film. We need to talk about movies, and it's a movie we probably do need to talk about. So, yeah, I don't know how I missed it, or I've never even heard of it, and B, how it ever got made.
And C, how on earth they managed to persuade one Sam Elliott to star in it.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, yeah. Sam Elliott and the younger, because he plays, a chap plays his younger self, is Poldark, isn't he?
Aidan Turner.
Yeah.
Yes.
I didn't realise that till you Googling afterwards. I thought, oh, I recognise him. Not that I've ever watched Poldark, but...
I haven't.
I've got the poster pinned up on my bedroom. But we come round to The Man Who Killed Hitler and Then the Bigfoot in a little bit, because first of all, I always like to ask around this time, Nathan, have you seen anything else this week?
I notice you've changed the question a little bit.
Oh, have I?
Yeah.
What, have you watched any other films? I usually ask, don't I?
you do, yeah.
And then you talk about telly for 20 minutes.
Yeah, unfortunately, once again, I haven't managed to find the time to squeeze in another movie. Literally, I've just had a bit of final space on in the background, but that's it.
Yeah.
How about yourself?
We did watch a film with the kids, a Disney Plus film the other night. No, it was on Netflix. Was it called The Sleepover? Sort of a kids' family film. But, yeah, we quite enjoyed that. It starred Malin Ackerman. I don't know if you've seen her in stuff. I've seen her in stuff. She's in loads of stuff. One of them people you recognise and you don't quite know where you recognise her from.
Right.
Oh, she was in Watchmen. She was in The Heartbreak Kid.
Yeah, I know the one.
Really recognisable.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a silly kids film where they're all having a sleepover and she turns out to be a spy. She gets kidnapped in the night and the kids have to go on this adventure to find her.
Right, yeah.
And, you know, it's... I feel... If I was, between the ages of 17 and 30, I'd probably, turn my nose up at this sort of film. But when you're watching it with kids, you get into films a bit more readily, you know? You're more willing to enjoy a film. If the kids are enjoying it, we're all laughing. There were some really funny bits in it. Some of it's really cheesy. The kid actors was quite good in it. Yeah, I thought it was all right. And that's all I've watched, really, this week. Except for more films from my series that I'm doing, which is... Films that I own that I haven't watched yet. I've watched a couple more of them.
Films that I borrowed but I never gave back.
Yeah. Something like that. But you have to go over to Hag Films and check them out. But that's it, really, Nath. So, yeah, I ain't got a lot to talk about this week.
Maybe we don't need to talk about movies.
No. But then over on the Hag Films site, you know, a couple of people commented up. Actually, on the Facebook group this week, I posted a question. Tell me what you guys have been watching. I'd like to hear what you guys have been watching this week. And, you know, the response was overwhelming.
Yeah.
No one even acknowledged it. Didn't even get a like. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that didn't work. Never mind, Nath.
So nobody responded by saying this week they've been watching The Man Who Killed Hitler and then The Bigfoot?
No, no. But people had commented on Capone, which at this point, as we're recording, this was the last podcast to go live.
Yeah.
And they've commented over on the Hag Films channel on YouTube, which is where you can go to comment on such things. Basically, yeah, it was people just agreeing with us, Nath. Walks with Ollie said, like you, I was expecting something else from Capone. I turned it off after an hour. I was actually relieved to find that you didn't spend 49 minutes talking about it. And then the Stealthy Coward said, Capone was such a disappointment. Like Nath mentioned, why would you make it about the most boring year of his life when he's had the life he has? Exactly our sentiments on it, really.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Wasted time.
Yeah.
There are far better films out there to review.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what the hell were we thinking? We need to review The Man Who Killed Hitler and then... The Bigfoot. Should we just get straight into it? Should we just get straight into it? Keep that short and sweet this week, shall we? And just chat.
Yeah. So, Trev.
Right. You're asking me.
Now, I have to be honest. I watched the film previously and I knew what I was going into watching this.
Yeah.
How did you feel about it after the title?
Well, I was sort of intrigued. I mean, is it this type of film like Sharknado and stuff? That's what I was thinking. Is it going to be like that?
Yeah.
Just what is this going to be about? Actually, I, like you said, with when you watch Capone,
yeah,
you found it mesmerizing to watch. And I thought the same with this. I didn't know where it was going, what was going on, but it was sort of easy watching. It was fun.
Yeah,
Sam Elliott has just got a presence, hasn't he? You could just watch him being him, being old.
Yeah.
I didn't not enjoy the film. I didn't think it was amazing, but I didn't not enjoy it, if I'm honest, Nath. I think I enjoyed it more than Capone.
Yeah. Good. I got to be fair, right? Because my initial, when we initially spoke about this, I said, are you sure? Because it's awful. And then when I watched it back a second time, I was like, I felt bad. I felt awful was a bit strong. It's not awful. It's just,
no,
it's quite random, isn't it?
It is random. But it's got a nice pace to it.
Yeah, that sounds like you're being polite.
No, it is. It's like, it just plods on. And then it sort of goes backwards and forwards. You know, it's him as an old man. I didn't know if it's going to be like an action, a cheesy action, but it's not, is it? It's a really poignant story of a man who's nearing the end of his days.
Yeah.
It's about regret. It's about missed opportunities. Coming to terms with who you are. It's like...
It's a lot. It's a lot crammed into what it is.
Yeah, it is. It's really interesting. I always say interesting. That's my word when I describe a film. What does that feel like? Interesting. But it was interesting, you know. It was... There was something about it. I liked it a lot more than I ever expected I would.
Well, that actually surprises me. Yeah. I mean, when I first started watching it the first time and you meet Sam Elliott's character for the first time and you realise he's a bit of a cantankerous sort of grumpy sort of old man. And when you get the, so you get introduced to him in the bar and sort of, he's just sat there on his own drinking and he's quite grumpy towards the barman. Mm-hmm. And he has a flashback, doesn't he? And it sort of, but it doesn't give everything away. And sort of it leaves you wondering. And then he decides he's going to go home. And this scene where he's going to get in his car, it sort of, he basically has a run-in with a couple of thugs trying to steal his money and his car.
Yeah.
And then you suddenly realize that he's not just an old man, you know, he's a very hard old man.
Yeah. I think you knew that scene was coming though. You could see when the, like, I didn't know, cause you see the car pull out sort of following him.
Yeah.
But then you see three lads in the background sort of dart across. And as he's coming to get in his car, I thought, he's going to beat them all up here. And I thought it was going to be the start of like an action film. And this was the sort of thing we was going to see throughout the film.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But it didn't quite go that way, even though he did, as you said, beat them all up.
After watching that scene, I was really excited about a potential sort of Gran Torino-esque kind of film. you know?
Yeah.
And, but I think I liked Sam Elliott's character because I like the grumpy old man. Yeah, kind of film. Like, you know, I really enjoyed Gran Torino for that reason, you know?
Yeah.
So, so our main character, Sam Elliott, who is Calvin Barr, is, as you say, nearing the end of his days, and he's led quite the life in his younger days, but he's not really overly happy with himself or his actions, maybe?
No. But that's it. You see the sort of the build up. The first scene, let's talk about just before he beats them lads up, he's in the bar, isn't he? And it cuts to a flashback of him going in to kill Hitler.
Yeah.
And I just loved that scene where he goes in and the bloke's checking all of his items, isn't he, before he lets him in to see Hitler.
Yeah.
And he's dressed in the SS gear.
Yeah.
The black leather jacket and the fancy hat. And he takes off his belt and hands over his hip flask and he checks his watch when he gets in.
That is just brilliant. If you didn't mention it, I was going to mention that. It's just such a random detail, isn't it?
It's brilliant though, because it's like the watch that it doesn't tell the time. It's just a swastika going around on his watch. And it's like, it's got four ends of a swastika pointing at different bits moving every second. It makes no sense, but I just thought, oh, that's just great. That's great.
And the guy that's checking him, like, it just, it's weird, isn't it? Because it's just like a comedy scene almost, isn't it? You know what I mean? It's just, it's not in any way serious. And then the guy's trying to keep, because the building's getting bombed that they're in, and the guy's trying to keep the plaster out of his drink because he's just poured some away, isn't he? And he's just poured himself a new one. And just everything about what he's doing, because there's no real conversation going. It is just sort of actions and motions and gestures, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's just, it's a comical little scene, isn't it?
Yeah, it's brilliant. I really enjoyed it. And then he goes through and then all these items that he's had, he starts putting together to make like a weapon to go and kill Hitler. And I just thought, it leads you into thinking what type of film you're going to watch. But the film you end up watching is completely not that film, is it?
Yeah, it does lead you down many false avenues, so to speak, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. And then you go back to Sam Neill, like you say, and then he beats up them people. But they sort of come over and they mugging him, aren't they? And give me your wallet.
Yeah.
And he's already just given that homeless guy his money. He's like, oh, I haven't got any money. I've just given the homeless guy the last of my money. And then they see the photo and they stub the fag out in the picture of his wife, don't they? Or his old girlfriend.
Yeah.
And I was waiting for it, like this bit where he's going to beat them all up. And it's not like a big action scene. It's just...
It's quick.
A few swift moves, yeah. And he's disabled them all. And I thought it was great. And
he's pissed off with it as well. He's pissed off with him. He's pissed off with having to do it. And, yeah.
And he's heartbroken that they've put a fag out in that picture of his woman, isn't he?
Yeah.
Because he's sobbing. The next shot, he's crying his eyes out. And you just think, I wasn't expecting... I don't know. It's like... There is, like I say, it's poignant. This film is really quite a sentimental story behind a ridiculous title and a ridiculous premise.
I just honestly, when I found that title on Netflix, and I don't know how I find it, you have to understand why there was absolutely no possible way I could pass it by without watching it. And when you see it, Sam Elliott as well, you're like, oh my God, well, that's a must, isn't it? You know what I mean? But yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, so he drives home, doesn't he? And he goes to bed. Does he go to bed straight away? I can't remember.
He probably has a look under his box, under his bed at the box first.
Yeah, that's right.
Gets his little wooden box out, goes to open it, decides not to open it, puts it back.
Yeah. The dog walks through, doesn't it?
The dog, he's with his dog.
You see, this is another thing. He's got a golden retriever in the same way that Clint Eastwood has in Gran Torino as well. And you're just like, and he's a grumpy old man living in a house on his own, driving a pickup truck. And I'm like, oh my God, the parallels are just never ending.
Yeah.
But he's, not quite as it seems. But he goes to visit his hairdresser, doesn't he?
That's right. And he's like, oh, notices the clock that's the wrong way round, and then when he sits to have his hair cut, he's like, it's a mirror clock. It's the right way in the mirror.
So you find out that basically his hairdresser's his brother.
Yeah. It's Larry Miller, isn't it? I've seen him. It's one of those people you've seen in everything.
Yeah.
But you don't... I can't quite put my finger in where I recognise him from the most. And I look at his filmography, and he's done everything, you know? Everything. The Three Fugitives, Pretty Woman, L.A. Story. Just loads of comedy films. You've seen him. Everyone's seen him.
Yeah. But I thought he was really good in this. I thought he plays Sam Elliott's little brother really well.
Yeah, I loved that relationship between him and his brother as well. And he really looks up to Sam Elliott. And he's like, you know, if you want to, he'd love to spend time with him. I want to go fishing with you. You know, we can talk or we could just... sit. He just wants to be with his older brother, doesn't he? It's a lovely relationship. And it feels like brothers. I don't know. That's what I mean. There's so many bits of this film. I think, oh, I'm enjoying this. I'm enjoying watching this relationship. I'm enjoying trying to work out, what's in that box?
Yeah. You know, because the film's still building at this point, and you get the feeling that Sam Elliott wants to talk to his brother, but doesn't really know where to begin or what to say or how to go about it, you know?
Yeah.
You quickly build up this picture that this man is really struggling with a lot of things in his life, you know? Or psychological, in his history, in his past. Is, you know, there's a lot there buried, or that he's trying to bury, or that he's, like you say, trying to come to terms with. And, he's a stressed old man. But he sort of wanders about the town, doesn't he, sort of slowly, and sort of you keep getting these flashbacks of himself as a younger man, don't you?
Like when he meets his wife, when he's working in a hat shop. I keep calling it his wife, it's not his wife.
No, it's his old girlfriend.
It's his old girlfriend who he never proposed, you keep seeing in flashback, he's trying to propose to her, and he can never quite get round to it.
No, the timing's never quite right, eh?
No, and he's hung on it, isn't he? You know, and still to this day, he's thinking of her. And it's lots of sort of symbolism in this film that you're trying to think, what's that representing? What is in that box? What is the stone in his shoe?
Yeah, that's a reoccurring theme, isn't it?
But I think at the end, he finds the stone, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And I think the stone in his shoe was, well, it's the fact that when he's gone and killed Hitler, it was ineffective.
Yep.
And that's what I loved about it as well, because I think, oh, how are they going to do this killed Hitler thing? And it's like, he killed Hitler, but it was silenced by the Americans. It was silenced by the Nazis, and they just put other people in, yeah, in Hitler's place. And it was the ideology that lived on.
Yeah, the damage had already been done.
I thought that was great. And it's a really great speech he does. There's some really great lines in this. It's really well written.
Yeah, that.
And I love the bit where he's talking about Hitler, and he says, I just killed a man. The monster lived on. He said, by the time I met that miserable little man, oh God, I've tried finding the quote because I was writing bits down, and I wish I'd sort of gone back and written all the quotes from this film, because there's some really good dialogue in it.
Yeah.
And that was one of them, where he's talking about Hitler.
That scene where he's sat at the kitchen table and he's, because it feels like it's the first time he's spoken about it since it happened.
Yeah.
And you can tell just the emotion in his face and the way he's talking, you know, it was so well delivered. And you just, I don't know. It just doesn't feel like it belongs in a film with that title, you know?
No, that's it. There's so much in it that's really, it makes sense, and it's really well written. It was a really, when you suggested this film, I was like, oh God, this is going to, but that's what I mean. I watched it and it's got me thinking, and I love coming away from a film and like continuing to want to think about it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and we said the other week that, you know, for Capone, for all its ambiguity, I didn't care. I didn't want to know the answers. I couldn't be bothered to spend another thought on that film afterwards, yeah, to sort of Google, was the, you know, the end a dream? Was, did he really shoot the gardener? And I didn't want to, I thought, I just can't be fucked to know that. Whereas with this, there's nothing on the line. I've been Googling stuff, trying to find like good information about it, and there's not really anything there. It's so it's just left me thinking. But it sort of edges the story out so slow. You, like you say, you see him walking around the town. He sees his brother. He finds the lottery ticket. It's a winner. £100 been won on this scratch card, and he takes it into the shop, and the lads are like, well, just have it, just claim the money. And he's like, no, I'll leave it here. Yeah. Oh, then the bloke goes, oh, well, here, I have a dog treat for your dog.
Yeah.
And then he goes, oh, I'll pay for it. And he gives him this old dollar bill.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And he's like, oh, you know, they burn them every now and again. They get discontinued and they burn them. And then the lad says, well, sometimes the old ones just hang around, or something like that. And it's like, is that the only reason this scene is there, for him to say that, which is symbolises you being an old one? It also shows his character, doesn't it? He will pay his own way.
Yeah, he's a strongly moral man. And that's half of his problem, isn't it? He's struggling to live with the things that he's done in his life.
Yeah. So then you see that, and you also see the flashback where he's having the shave, isn't it?
Yeah, that is a weird scene, isn't it?
And it's the bloke who's paid him, or the bloke, is it them who are getting him
he's basically been put in contact with these Russian, almost like gypsies, if you like.
Yeah.
That are like freedom fighters, I suppose, that are helping him. He's got to their country without being seen, and he, you know, he's obviously behind enemy lines, and they're helping him get to where Hitler is. Whether they're helping him with the outfit and everything, I don't know, because they managed to get hold of a German Shepherd for him, which is something that an SS officer might walk around with, you know, just to sort of help complete the disguise, I suppose.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of, I suppose in that scenario, there's a lot of mistrust going on, you know, and I think maybe there was a little bit between the Germans and the Russians anyway during the war, and sort of there's this initial interaction and it's very tense, and he doesn't seem overly comfortable in the situation. And then this Russian starts talking to him about this perfect shave. And
if I give you the perfect shave, you'll fail the mission. and you'll be cursed. And
that's it. But if I cut you, you'll be successful in your mission. But I can't try to cut you. They both have to be honest. That's what it is.
It's another sort of really strange scene. But again, I just happily watching these things that are happening that not making complete sense, but are really done well.
It is amazing how they managed to tie all of these random scenes together to actually make a coherent storyline.
A kind of coherent storyline. It's like, I don't know, there's bits in it where you think, well, that wasn't necessary. Nothing's really explained.
No.
But that scene was really, I quite enjoyed watching it, as I said, just him being shaved and Aidan Turner just sitting there. He didn't really say a lot in that scene, does he? But
no.
He's not poorly acted. You just think, at what point has someone read a script to this and gone, yep, we're in? How did he pitch it? How did he get Sam Elliott in it and Aidan Turner? And more importantly, Douglas Trumbull is executive producer, and he also provided the special effects. Douglas Trumbull, Nath, if you're not aware, he done the special effects, the Stargate sequence in 2001, A Space Odyssey.
Oh, right.
He'd done all the special effects for Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Yep.
He'd done the middle sequence of The Tree of Life. You know, the Dawn of Time sequence.
Yes, yeah, I'm with you.
You know, all these amazing special effects. And you'd think if he was producing a film, it would be full of amazing special effects. But it's not, is it? I can't understand how they got him on board. He provided the special effects for this film.
Yeah.
What special effects were there in this film? A bullet hole in the back of Hitler's chair. I can't think of any other bits where there was. It was like really quite rubbish green screen of him climbing up.
Oh, that mountain. Oh, my God, that was horrendous.
You can tell it's not real. It's like, well, why have they gone to Douglas Trumbull to do the effects? And if they've gone to him, why are they look so rubbish? So
in certain places, especially when you see the Bigfoot costume, you think they've gone out of their way to make it look hammy.
Oh, is it the same costume as the apes from the beginning of 2001?
They've just dug it out of the closet and just, oh.
Douglas, can we borrow the, go on then. They've just given him a producer title because he's provided the suit.
Yeah, all of the hair has fallen out of it over the years. Yeah. And that's what they're left with.
But it's like, it's like a cross between the Apes out of 2001 or the old Planet of the Apes with like Michael Jackson's face. It's just really weird Bigfoot. But I love the line as well. But this is the thing as well. The story, as I say, it goes really slowly talking about, you know, showing us the backstory, him courting his wife, the people coming up in the restaurant and interrupting him every time he's trying to propose.
Yep.
And then you think, it's an hour and 45 minutes. It's an hour and 45 minutes, the film. And you're thinking, we're nearly an hour in. They haven't even mentioned Bigfoot yet.
Yeah.
And then, as I was thinking that, then he gets a knock at the door and it's the FBI, which is...
Yes.
Ron Livingston out of the Band of Brothers comes in, doesn't he?
Yep.
And he's sort of saying, you know, we need you to come and kill Bigfoot.
This is where it gets really ridiculous. This is where it just gets... just like... Hang on a minute. We've got to try and squeeze the Bigfoot bit in somehow.
And this is it. It is squeezed in as well. It's like, all right, Bigfoot, spreading a virus or something? Is he attacking people?
No, basically...
Started the plague.
Yeah, you see little bits and pieces in the newspaper where it cuts to and it glances by very quickly that there's something happening in Canada, isn't there? You know?
Yeah.
And the media are spinning it the way they want to do, and the FBI have decided to let it go the way they have. But basically, the Bigfoot is ill. It's in Canada, and basically it's spreading this virus and it's wiping out all of the wildlife it comes across, fish, elk, deer, sort of everything. But somehow, through some amazing feat, they've actually decided that Sam Elliott, who's like got to be in his 70s and is some old retired man living in the middle of nowhere, they've managed to get hold of his DNA or a blood sample, test it. He's immune to the virus. He's one of only three people in the world that could do this job, but he's the only one that's alive. So they've come knocked on his door because A, he can track an animal, and B, he's immune to the virus. Oh, right, sweet. But you're the only one. Just what on earth is that about?
Yeah, so then he goes, kills Bigfoot.
Yeah.
Goes and tracks him down. They drop him in the ring of fire.
Oh, no. Because you got to get to the bit where he rides in the helicopter, and then all of a sudden, it's like the most advanced space-age sci-fi film. It's like something out of Alien, you know what I mean? And they've all got these suits on, there's big flashlights, there's a big dome in the middle of nowhere, there's a fire burning in the background, and it's just like, what the fuck? Am I still watching the same film?
But don't they just... He goes and kills the Bigfoot, he tracks him down, shoots him in the head, and then Bigfoot runs off.
Yeah.
And then he, like, breaks his finger, and his finger's all twisted out of shape. And he's like, they've talked to him on the walkie-talkies. Have you seen it? And he's like, shot it. Where'd you shoot it? In the head. Is it dead? I broke my pinky.
The fifth digit on my left hand.
Fifth digit. And then, and they go, but you've seen it? And he goes, not, he hasn't got big feet. Doesn't live up to the legend. And then he goes, tracks him down, and you see this weird Bigfoot creature. They have a bit of an altercation.
Yeah.
Then he does kill him.
Yeah.
Well, he goes to burn him, and then the Bigfoot's alive. He says, sorry about this, big fella, or something. I'm not letting you let him have your body, big fella.
Yeah.
And he goes to burn him, and then Bigfoot's alive again. And then they have another fight. Eventually, he kills him.
Yeah, but not before he's had his ear bitten off and his arm broken.
Yeah.
And then he's stabbing the hell out of Bigfoot with his knife. Oh, my God, no, the weapon scene where he goes... That rifle, that scope, that this brilliant. Knife, that's it.
Yeah, that's it. And it's like the camera zooms into him to say, that's it. But it's like slightly mistimed. Just looks awful, but it's great. What a great scene. They go, oh, what weapons have we got? He goes, oh, I've had to dig into my personal arsenal. And then there's like, he goes into this room and there's just weapons all over the wall. That rifle, that scope, that knife, that's it. But then this is the sort of thing I was thinking, right, so the end half of this film now is going to be this stupid action.
Yeah.
But it's not. Within 10 minutes...
Yeah.
The Bigfoot plot is done.
All been and gone.
And now we're at his funeral.
Oh, mate, no. We forgot the bit where Bigfoot's being sick on him.
Oh, my God, yeah. I'm not looking at my notes, is the trouble here.
And whilst he's tracking Bigfoot and then he's fingering through his shit and he's like, vegetarian.
He sniffs it. Vegetarian, yeah.
Oh, but just what the fuck?
It is so weird. It was weird, but I enjoyed it for it being so weird, you know?
Yeah, no, I get it.
Like when he goes in to see Hitler and he does the Hitler salute to Hitler.
Yeah.
And he's crossing his fingers behind his back. I don't mean that. It's like and then yeah, that when Bigfoot is sick on him, it's just,
oh, it's vile, isn't it?
Where's that come from? So yeah, it's all in his face, and but it's all right because he's
immune.
But yeah, then it's like you wait for an hour before Bigfoot's mentioned. There's that poignant scene just before he goes, where he goes and meets his brother for hot chocolate.
Yeah, that's a real heart-wrenching scene, isn't it? Like, you
it's
know,
just a touching little scene, isn't it? And he's like, he tells him, I've got to go and do something. Does he tell him he's got to kill Bigfoot? He does tell him, doesn't he?
Yeah.
got to get it to Bigfoot. And he's like, oh, that doesn't sound very good. He said, I'm not going to go. He goes, well, you must be thinking about it. If you've called me out at like 3 a.m. to have a chat.
Yeah.
So then he goes.
But Sam Elliott's like, why do you believe a word I'm telling you? And his brother's like, he's like a bad man's always a bad man, and a so-and-so will always be a so-and-so. And he's like,
a liar will always be a liar. Yeah.
And an honest man will always be an honest man. And it's a real, real.
That's another one of those scenes where it's just great dialogue.
Yeah.
And great. And it's a great summation of his character, isn't it? You know?
Yeah. And it's weird because, like, his little brother looks up to him so much, but yet it's him that's seeking the counsel of his little brother and his little brother's advice, and it's his advice that sort of really sends him in the end, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's a great, it is a great little scene, but then it just gets so ridiculous after that that it just, I don't even know. Do you think that when they watched it back after they'd finally cut it all together, do you think they got to the end of the Bigfoot scene, all looked at each other, and then fell about laughing?
It's got to be a comedy, hasn't it? They've got to be doing it for a comical effect.
I hope so.
I mean, it says on IMDb it's an action drama sci-fi.
Yeah, that well-recognised genre.
But you can't. They can't be serious. They can't be serious when they're doing this. But this is what I was saying anyway. What I'm trying to say is that it's so a slow build up. Then they, like you say, squeezed in the Bigfoot story because 10 minutes, that's wrapped up.
Yeah.
But the film's still got another like half an hour left.
Yeah.
So then he's dead, you're at his funeral, and you think, oh, he died, and his brother gives this really nice speech and says, you know, my brother loved a man once.
Didn't love a man.
No, my brother loved a woman once, and she died too young. So then you find out why they didn't sort of marry.
Yeah.
And then he says, I always miss my brother, or something. Yeah, just some really nice speech, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. It was a touching sort of end, like, you know.
And then you see him, the brother, then cutting hair, and then someone says, "Oh, sorry to hear about your brother. You know, he was a good man, but at least he didn't die in his house. Died on holiday, didn't he? At least he didn't die in that old house on his own."
Yeah.
You know. And then the brother goes fishing, and then you see Sam Neill.
Elliot.
Sam Elliott. Then you see Sam Elliott. I always say Sam Neill when I'm talking about Sam Elliott. But he stood at the edge, and at first I'm like, is it a dream then? Or is he imagining him he's there? And then, oh no, he is there. And then he's like, what did you bury? Oh, your old suit and that box. Buried that box. So you find out then that Sam Elliott isn't dead. He's faked his own death.
Yeah.
So he's... Is it so he doesn't get hassled again? Or so you think he's going to go into hiding, but the next scene he's in the most public place there is at the school.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that just doesn't tie together, does it?
No. I mean, him and his brother have a scene at the school when they're watching the school play, and Sam Elliott says something weird. Basically, the brother's granddaughter is a butterfly in the play.
Yeah.
And he says something like, butterflies all dead this time of year. Most butterflies are dead this time of year. He's like, hey, you know, don't say that. What are you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But this is where he gives, go on, what's you going to say?
I was going to talk about the real touching moment, because when Sam Elliott's character, the young Calvin Barr, sort of leaves to go to Europe to fight in the war, his brother gives him that little model of a dinosaur, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Because it's his favourite one.
Yeah.
And you see him later when he's trying to sleep in the cave with...
After he's had the fall, isn't it? With Bigfoot.
Yeah. Whilst he's tracking Bigfoot, doesn't he? And you see him... he sets it up on a little stone just facing out, like almost like it's going to protect him during the night.
Yeah.
And then... He looks at his brother, and he doesn't even look at his brother, does he? He just gets it out, and he just feels for his brother's hand, and he just puts it in his brother's hand. It's a real convincing portrayal of a guy that really doesn't know how to speak to his brother, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. But he wants to.
Yeah, that's it. He's trying to reach out in a way that he can, or that, you know, his character would, you know?
Yeah. It's just, that's what I mean. It's like, it's this nonsense plot. The Bigfoot bit is all nonsense.
But
the rest of the film is fine, isn't it? Without the Bigfoot bit? Even the Hitler plot isn't out of its place, is it? You know?
No.
But I suppose that's his resolution. That's his stone in his shoe, is not saving people. Whereas now he's killed Bigfoot, he's killed someone, and it will have an effect because the plague won't spread.
Yeah.
And he saved millions of people. Then the stone comes out of his shoe. He's resolved a lot of issues. He's let his brother know that he's always...
Well, he's always loved him, always thought of him.
Always been in his thoughts. Yeah. He's always kept that toy, you know?
So he mends his relationship with his brother. He saves humanity from a fate worse than Hitler.
Yeah.
Which comes in the form of a really badly dressed Bigfoot. And then...
he's not badly dressed. He's not like Bigfoot in flares. But that's what I like about as well, what he says about Hitler. He says, what do you think that haircut was? What do you think that moustache was? It's a costume.
Yeah.
And I just think, well, that makes sense. It's brilliant, the way that angle they've looked at it at.
Yeah. So it could just be...
Anyone could dress up as that's Hitler. Once he was dead, they still had that costume to carry it on.
And the thing is who in their right mind is going to contest it, you know? And you know no one would.
Hmm.
So basically he wakes up after the play, and at the play when he's speaking to his brother, he sort of, his brother apologizes for burying the box, doesn't he? And he's like, no, it's fine. And then he goes home and he goes to bed, and then for whatever reason in the middle of the night, he just wakes up and he just speaks to his dog, and he's like, come on, we got something to go and do. And you see him go to the shed, and it's almost like an action film tooling up montage, isn't it? Where he's lighting his little lamp, and he's digging out his shovel, and he's getting his bits and pieces. And then they go down to the graveyard, and just in the middle of the night, he just digs up his own grave. Which, like, and I know it's a small detail, but not being funny, for a man of his age to go out single-handedly and dig out 6 foot of earth to get down to that grave, that coffin, and to open the coffin, that must have been a monumental feat. But he rescues his box, doesn't he?
Yeah, and you think, oh, this is it. We're going to look in this box now. He goes to open it, and then he does it. We never see him open it.
No.
He never shows us what's in it, but he never looks in it himself.
No.
What do you make of that?
I wondered at one point if there was like an old gun in there and he was considering taking his own life.
Yeah, could be.
That was one take on it.
I wonder if it's like a sort of a Pandora's box thing, curiosity. I don't know, because he must know what's in it. But it's just a strange thing, but really well written. The writer, I don't think we've mentioned his name, Robert D. Kwiatkowski, wrote and directed this.
Yeah. What's he done then?
Nothing.
And he's not like...
He's produced a film called the co-produced Paradise Falls. What's that?
I think I've seen that.
And The Woman, Paradise Falls.
I think I've seen that.
1997, so a long time ago. So there must be someone in the industry.
No, I haven't seen that.
But he's only written this and Elsie Hooper.
Right.
Which is a short film. So I don't know what that was about. So he's obviously got this off of the back of that.
Yeah.
He'd done the visual effects for Elsie Hooper. So whether that was quite a stunning film, I don't know. That's managed to get Douglas Trumbull on board. I don't know, but I wonder if this was like, I want to make a film. I don't know what I'm going to make it about. Everyone write a scene down, put it in the hat. Right? And I'll pick one out. Oh, man at a bar. Right. Man at a bar. Old man at a bar. Right. Next, what's that? Oh, a man about to kill Hitler. Right, yeah, right. That's the next scene. Because nothing ties together. It's all... Oh, I don't know. It's one of them for films where it shouldn't be as good as it is. I shouldn't have enjoyed it as much as I did. But, yeah, I did, Nathan. I'd like to thank you for suggesting this film this week.
That in itself seems ridiculous because it was definitely not the response I was expecting.
No, it's one of those films where I shouldn't... I didn't want to watch it. I was like, oh, God. Is this going to be rubbish? You know?
I had visions in my head when I suggested it to you, like... Because this was the film that I thought about, and I'd thought about it way before the weekend came around, and I was just like, no, I've got to be able to think of something else. Something else has got to come up. And then when you prompted me for it, I was like, no, that's all I've got. That is all I've got. The man who killed Hitler and then the Bigfoot.
I would never have seen it, Nath. I've never heard of it, you know? And if you hadn't have suggested it, I'd never have known this film existed. And, well, like I say, Nath, I'm glad you chose it. I probably won't let you choose another film for a week or two, though. But...
Cheers, mate.
Let us know if you've watched it in the audience out there, our listeners.
If you haven't, please go and watch it and comment.
Yeah, definitely worth a butcher's.
Yeah.
I still don't want to watch, like, Sharknado and all shit like that, though, if I'm honest.
No, I don't. You know, snakes on a plane, Sharknado, any of that. No.
And this is what I had in my head. It was going to be something like that, you know?
Yeah, no, I get that.
It was just this strange film about a man who killed Hitler.
And then very conveniently, just to tie the plot up together, he went away for 10 minutes and killed Bigfoot.
Just to tie the title up.
Yeah. It's like, no. We've sold them on the title. We need to make the Bigfoot thing work. But no, the film's all right without it. No.
It's an hour and a half long. It's nice. It's a short film about a man who killed Hitler once, lost his girlfriend because the war kept him apart. He's the only person he's got in touch is his brother. He's got this nice little relationship with his brother. No. We need a Bigfoot in there. And I can afford 10 minutes. I don't want to make it any longer than...
We just please, can we have Bigfoot being sick in his mouth?
Well, no, thanks ever so much for suggesting your film.
Well, thanks for letting me in. Thanks for watching it.
And thank you all for listening, if you have listened. People might have just looked at the name of this podcast and... Thought, oh, I won't bother downloading this week. I'll wait till they do something I recognise.
Yeah, maybe.
Or they might go, what the hell is this? This might be our most popular podcast. You never know.
It might significantly increase the amount of watches the film's had.
It might, yeah.
might go up to like 20.
Yeah. Well, peace out, everyone, and we'll catch you all again next week when we will be back to talk more about movies podcast. Nath,
cheese.